You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Good afternoon, I'm Bill DeLuca. Welcome to Television, Film, and Theater. This is our Theater 100 class that looks at the related arts that go on backstage. Today we're going to look at designing scenery, which is probably one of the most exciting parts of our work on stage. You know, when you go to a film, you usually just kind of follow the story, but when you walk into a live theater performance, you become very aware of what the designers have done in costumes and lighting, even in sound. But scenery is right in front of you, so it's very much an artistic statement as to how that fits in with the actual story. So today we're looking at designing scenery for the stage, but we're also bringing in a wonderful guest artist, Evan Bartoletti, who's done so many wonderful shows for us. So in the second half, I hope you'll join us to meet Evan and see some of the wonderful magic he's done with his scenery. So there's that toll-free number. Feel free to join us. This is an interactive medium, theater is. 1-800-339-1193. From anywhere in North America, you could ask a question or respond to some of the things that we're talking about, or go online and post us a question at askdhtvlive@gmail.com. So feel free to join us today. Some of the tidbits of information that my students need to hear is that there's no discussion board this week, so that's a wonderful thing. You don't have to be looking at the broadcast to find out what to write about, because hopefully you are writing about your play review, the play that you've gone to see. So that's due April 28th, so that's next Tuesday. So that's why we're not doing a discussion board this week, so that you can really focus on your final writing assignment for the class, the play review. And there's a quiz today, so that's also included. So we normally have been looking at the history of theater and television and film. Today we're all the way up to the 19th century, and that's always interesting because it's a fascinating time. And one of the most unique things about it is melodrama. So we're going to ask you a question. Why did melodrama become the favorite form of theater in 19th century America? And we'll get to that in time and talk about it, but I'd be curious to see what your response is. Why do you think melodrama then, as it is still with us today, was so popular? Okay, so 19th century theater, as we had said last week, introduces a whole new range of human beings. The working class finally gets to go to the theater. Prior to that, especially in the age of the 17th century, it had been the aristocracy, whereas in the 18th century, the middle class becomes fascinated with theater. Now, we are seeing people who have worked a 14-hour day looking for something thrilling on the weekend, and they'll go to this huge theater, some that seat 3,000 people, like the Bowery Theater in downtown New York, to see, well, we will talk about melodrama, but before we get there, one of the most unique things about 19th century theater were the great actors who graced the stage. And it began with a lot of English actors like Edmund Kean coming over from England and being able to do productions of Macbeth or Lear or whatever, usually it was a Shakespeare. Kean was famous for his wild personality, which was also infused by a great deal of alcohol. He had a lot of problems with that. But critics got to associate him with a kind of fiery disposition. In fact, one read, "Watching Kean was like reading Shakespeare by flashes of lightning." You never knew what was gonna come next with Edmund Kean. So he was quite passionate on stage. In fact, perhaps it was his alcoholism that caused him to burn out early in life, but he had quite a career both in England and touring in America as well. And there were many other stars that followed his lead. John Philip Kemble, Sarah Siddons, we have the names of William McCready, Madame Vestris, Henry Irving, you've all heard of Sarah Bernhardt. So these were great stars of the 19th century stage. Oddly enough, it wasn't until Edwin Forrest, who was an actor, there's a great image of him, famous for his role of Spartacus, But Forrest was a very physically strong man. He always played roles like Spartacus that were heroic roles. One role that he played was Metamora, or Prince of the Wampanoags, which was a kind of tragic Indian character. But he was always doing work that involved a very powerful physical performance. To some extent, we have Edwin Forrest to perhaps thank for the first real acting style that was truly American. And when you think of those that followed him, of the Marlon Brando kinds of sensibilities, he did help set a new standard, something that was original about America, that wasn't just copying what the English and French had done. So for that reason, he became very popular. He had an absolutely fanatical following. That's where that word fans come from. And he was, he actually was involved in some situations where there were riots because of his fans being so adamant about being passionate with him. Speaking of being passionate, one of the things about Forrest, funny in retrospect, but tough if you had to do any stage combat with him. If he got into a fight on stage, and in most of Shakespeare's history plays, you had to battle someone with a sword, or you had to do all kinds of pyrotechnical displays. His fight scenes got so overwrought that he sometimes, in a one-minute scene, would go on for 5 minutes. So the people who had to fight with him didn't know what was coming next. So he was very passionate, perhaps too much so. But one of the actors who actually became the most famous actor in terms of his artistic quality was, oddly enough, Edwin Booth. Edwin Booth was a great Shakespearean performer who, in fact, had the longest-running production of Hamlet in the 19th century. It wasn't until Paul Robeson in the 20th century would eclipse that. But Edwin Booth was a fine, tragic actor who had a wonderful sense of style and clarity. He went on to be a great director as well. Unfortunately, Edwin Booth had a brother named John Wilkes Booth. And we all know the history that that actor created at the Ford's Theater in killing Abraham Lincoln. And Edwin Booth was very distraught by it and kind of left the profession for quite a while. So some interesting but strange, perhaps, history. Okay, but once we get to the later 19th century, we get the Industrial Revolution figuring into the productions, so much so that America puts on shows that are highly spectacle-driven. This is actually a manual. All these images are on the front page of a manual that is used for creating stage effects on stage. And this is 1886. So you know that it must have been very popular to create images of boats on the water or avalanches. They were all how-tos explained in this manual. So it was very popular. And of course, what made it popular was melodrama. We've talked about melodrama before, but historically, we're looking at a form that emphasizes action and spectacular effects. The melodrama aspect is because music was always behind the scenes to heighten the mood. The characters were always what we call stock characters. In other words, you were either a villain or a good guy. So there wasn't much depth in terms of the characterizations. So these shallow characters also allowed the themes of the play to be basically about good versus evil. In fact, at the end, good usually has to win. So the triumph of good comes after a long, hopefully circuitous path of one battle scene after another. So spectacle found its home in melodrama. We still do melodrama today. If you're looking at soaps, you won't see that much spectacle. Well, I shouldn't say that. There's a lot of violence that involves our afternoon soaps as well. But what was unique is how spectacle began to overpower the meaning of the play. And there's one very good example of how this happened, which is Uncle Tom's Cabin. Oddly enough, this is the most famous socially relevant book that may have ever been written, right? Harriet Beecher Stowe writes this as an abolitionist story to tell what was going on down south and speak out against slavery in the southern states. In fact, when Abraham Lincoln met her, he said to Harriet Beecher Stowe, "So you're the little lady who started this Civil War." Anyway, what happens is many different companies were fascinated with the idea of making this a stage play. And there weren't any royalties then, so Harriet Beecher Stowe, who did not want it to go to stage, she feared what might happen if it got to be a show. She wanted to keep it just a novel. She did not authorize any performances, so there were a good 15 to 20 different versions of Uncle Tom's Cabin that were played out on stage. Some of them became very popular because of the spectacle that was involved. So you could see live horses on stage, there was an avalanche, there was the ascendancy at the end to heaven. But perhaps one of the most famous scenes was Eliza crossing the frozen Ohio River to freedom. I think we have an image of that, or I guess this image is there he is. People would go to see this show because they had live horses on stage. You can't really see it that well, but this is an actual photo that goes back to that time where you're seeing Eliza standing on a frozen section of the river with her baby going to freedom. Well, what happened was people became more fascinated with the spectacle in Uncle Tom's Cabin and less so with the social commentary that was involved in the show. So people came to see the spectacle and not hear about the social issues. And it's amazing how popular it became. There were some 500, they call them Tom companies, by the end of the 19th century. Companies of actors who were just performing Uncle Tom's Cabin, traveling all around the country doing this show. People couldn't get enough of it. In fact, by 1927, there were still a dozen Tom companies playing the show. You would like to think, oh, well, that's because of the the interest in social issues, but unfortunately, it was more because of the spectacle involved. So, yes, to some extent, scenery can be your undoing if you're hoping to get a message across. There's a little clip from Uncle Tom's Cabin I want to show you, which is actually from a film, a silent film that was made later, but you will see some of the setups that had been there in the stage play. So here's a little clip from Uncle Tom's Cabin. Of course, that was shot on location, so that made it easy for the silent film to be made. However, in the actual stage play that they came to see in the 1880s, all that had to be created. Live horses, though, that was amazing to see live horses on stage. But you had to recreate the Ohio River to do Uncle Tom's Cabin. And that was the fascination, more the spectacle than the message. By the time we get to the end of the 19th century, America is doing such amazing performances that involve all kinds of technology. We even have theaters that are designed to show the power of what technology can do. This is Steele McKay's famous Madison Square Theater. This is 1879, still very early at the end of the 19th century. But this is an elevator stage. I don't know how well you can see it, but right now, the audience is watching a performance on the lower stage, and upstairs, there's another stage that they can't see where the stagehands are changing the scenery for the next scene. So what would happen is when the scene downstairs is done, they would bring the lights down, maybe bring the curtain down, and actually hydraulically drop the top section into place so that they could raise the curtain, and there's the next scene for them to play. Meanwhile, the poor stagehands, who are all the way upstairs, have to go down a stairwell to get to the bottom, the cellar now, and get the next scene ready so that that can be lifted into place for the following scene. That's amazing technology and imagination as well, but it does show you the use of technology. Also, we had horse races on stage here. You could go to the Union Square Theater in 1890, see actual horses running on a conveyor belt so that they're literally going as fast as they can with real riders on top of them. And this cutaway shows under the stage a little bit of the machinery involved. And if you can see up above, there's actually, it's not very clear, but there's a backdrop there that was put onto spools that mounted vertically at the proscenium lines so that when they turned, it's one continuous piece of muslin painted so that when it turns, it actually looks like the landscape is moving behind these horses. So you really get a sense of being at the racetrack and watching the horse actually covering territory, but it's the territory in the background that's moving behind you. So again, it's pretty imaginative, but to be able to carry off such technology too is amazing. So this is what the Industrial Revolution brought to theater in the 19th century, especially in America. It all had a lot to do with wanting to create a sense of realism, even if it was spectacular realism. And we have these great directors like David Belasco, who was able to use lighting instruments. We now have electricity, and we actually have instruments that can project colored light. So a lot of the early innovations right after the introduction of electricity, within two or three decades, we were starting to get systems for how to use stage lighting and create beautiful images. Belasco has a famous scene in his Madame Butterfly that shows the movement from midnight to dawn with just the changing of light, and it takes like 7 minutes for the entire sequence. People went to the theater just to see that effect. So yes, spectacle was alive and well and living in New York City primarily. But also, it's interesting that in Europe, at this time comes the plays of Henrik Ibsen. Now, Ibsen was very driven by what is known as the well-made play. We've actually talked about that already. But he improved on the well-made play by putting in social issues that very much upset people at the time. I mean, some of his plays dealt with things like syphilis that made people just aghast at how he could deal with such a horrible problem. But of course, his most famous play had people very up in arms in 1879 when he writes Doll's House, which features a woman leaving her husband at the end of the play. In fact, what probably was most upsetting to people was how authentically and accurately he portrayed a marriage, an unequal marriage, a very unjust marriage as well, which is why it's called Dollhouse, because Nora is kept away from the world. And at the end of the play, she decides she wants to go into the world, pursue an education, and pursue more freedom for herself as an individual. This is a wonderful final scene that'll show you a little bit of the issues that Ibsen was dealing with and that soon became very much on everyone's minds as new playwrights began to take on social issues in their realistic plays. So this is a little clip from Doll's House by Henrik Ibsen.
Sit down, Torvald. You and I have a lot to talk about. Doesn't anything strike you about the way we're sitting here?
What?
We've been married 8 years. This is the first time that you and I, man and wife, have ever had a serious talk together.
You didn't expect me to drag you into all my worries. You couldn't possibly have helped me with that.
That's not what I mean. When I lived with Papa, he used to tell me what he thought about everything. And I took on his opinions. He used to call me his little doll. He used to play games with me just the way I played with my dolls.
Then I came to live in your house.
Have you never been happy here?
I always thought I was, but I haven't ever been. No, I've had fun. You've always been very kind to me, Torvald, but this house is like a playroom. My children have been my dolls.
Oh, you exaggerate.
I'm giving you my point of view for once.
So, playing is over. We'll begin again. Now comes time to learn.
Whose time to learn? Mine or the children's?
Both, my dear Nora.
Oh, Torvald, you're not the man to teach me to be the right wife for you. And what about me? Are I fit to educate the children? You said yourself that you couldn't leave them in my charge. You're right. I have to educate myself first, and you can't do that for me. That is something that I must do for myself. That is why I'm leaving you.
What did you say?
I'm leaving you now. Christine will put me up for tonight. Tomorrow I shall go home, to where I was born. It'll be easier for me to get a job there.
You've no experience of the world.
I must try to get some, Torvald.
You forget your most sacred duties. Your husband, your children, your position as mother and wife.
I have another duty. Equally sacred, if that is the word. My duty to myself.
You're first and foremost a wife and mother.
I can't believe that anymore. I believe that first and foremost I am a human being like you. Or I must become one.
I presume you have some sense of duty left. Or perhaps you haven't. Well, answer me.
Torvald, I simply don't know. All I know is that these things mean something quite different to me than they do to you. I have learned now that there are laws that are different from the way I imagine them to be, and I can't accept that such laws are right.
You don't love me.
No. That's exactly it.
Nora, how can you say such things to me?
I can't help it. I don't love you anymore. I waited patiently for 8 years. I'm not such a fool as to believe that miracles happen every day. And when this dreadful thing happened to me, I knew a miracle would come. When that letter from Krogstad was lying out there, it never occurred to me for a moment that you would accept his conditions. I knew that you would step forward and take the blame. Torvald, I never would have accepted such a sacrifice from you. But that was the miracle that I was waiting for. And it was to prevent the consequences to you that I was willing to take my life.
No man can be expected to sacrifice his honor, not even for the person he loves.
Millions of women have done it.
I have the strength to change, Nora.
Perhaps. If your doll is taken from you. I don't want to see the children. As I am now, I can be nothing to them.
Nora, can I never be anything but a stranger to you?
Oh, Torvald, I don't believe in miracles anymore. We would have to change so much.
And she leaves. It was said that the door slamming behind Nora was heard around the world because people recognized what she was saying as being truthful. Is your first duty, your sacred duty, as Torvald says, only to be wife and mother? And she says, no, I have a higher duty, which is to myself. Ibsen was not trying to write a woman's independence play. He was hailed for it. But at the same time, in many of his plays, he was looking at the independence of the human spirit. And many other writers, Anton Chekhov, for instance, who worked with Konstantin Stanislavski. Stanislavski was the famous acting theorist who kind of perfected naturalistic acting. And for Anton Chekhov's plays, very similar in a way to Ibsen, they were about how people really live their lives. It was very close to the issues that people were relating to. And even though we look at these plays today and they look seemingly realistic to us, at the time, they were a reaction against melodrama. Because melodrama was just being theatrical, just being over the top, give us a grand show. This was being honest. This was being very truthful. So a lot of these directors like Stanislavski were attempting to try something new, even though to us now it looks pretty old. But it was an amazing thing to create a realistic theater that was about the lives that we live today. So interesting little part of history here. I'll leave it at that because I want to talk about design, but it's unique how the 19th century began with all of this theatrics and great actors and wonderful spectacle, but it ends up with a movement towards what we call modern drama. The plays of Ibsen, Chekhov, Strindberg, many who wanted to say something about how we should really live our lives in terms of finding true happiness and true independence. So, very unique little section of history, but I do want to talk about design with you a little bit. And there's a great quote that Robert Edmund Jones used once, and I'll set this up as a possible way of interacting with you. What do you think Robert Edmund Jones meant when he said, "Players act in a setting, not against it"? Players, the actors, should be acting in a setting, not against it, meaning just in front of the setting. So what do you think this famous American scene designer, this is early 20th century, he actually wrote a famous book, The Dramatic Imagination, in 1941, in which he wrote this quote about being in the setting, not in front of it. So feel free to join us. There's our toll-free number, or you may want to go online and post a question, askdhtv@gmail.com. But we want to talk about scenery because this is a very unique part of theater. When you have to design where it's going to take place, you're really getting to the main artistry. And a lot of the costumes and lighting props are going to come from the concept that your designer has, your scene designer has. So we're really looking at all the arts of design, but today we're focusing really on scenery. And realize too that designers don't just think in images, they know the practicalities as well. So a good lighting designer knows the power of a certain instrument. Good designers, scene designers, know the sight lines of a theater. A good costume designer knows the measurements of the actors, even knows the skin tone of those actors before they design the costumes for them. So design is technical and artistic. But let's just look at scenery today. In terms of the history of scenery, I think if you've read Edwin Wilson, he shows that scenery really came in the Renaissance, because prior to that, for the Greeks and the Romans, for instance, for the Asians, there were very conventionalized structures that served each play. Every play, for instance, in the Greek tragedies takes place in front of a palace. So it really wasn't until we get to the Renaissance. And much of today's scenery is really a combination of the painted scenery that came in with the Renaissance, that 16th century fascination, remember, with painted perspective drawings on stage. So we still do that. We still use two-dimensional painted flats on like raked stages, but we also combine them now with architectural design. Three-dimensionality is the way to go today. We still use the upstage, downstage terminology and stage left and stage right. So that's still with us. And that technology, that terminology, the upstage, downstage, that actually derives from the Renaissance. So the actual stages were raked. In other words, they were kind of like a hill. So that when an actor actually walks towards the audience, they are literally walking down a hill. That's why we call that section towards the audience downstage, as well as the section up away from the audience, upstage. And we still use the performer's vista for what is on the performer's right and the performer's left when we identify these main areas of the stage. Upstage right, upstage left, downstage right, downstage left. We still use that terminology in rehearsal to help actors find where to go. When Edward Gordon Craig, I think we've referred to him a little bit, began using this idea in the 20th century, people really thought it was a miracle, the idea that you can have three-dimensionality, because we had been so used to everything just painted on flats, which kind of shows how well established it was. In fact, Adolf Appia was perhaps the true innovator of three-dimensional scenery. He didn't understand how you could have a three-dimensional actor who has depth by nature and then put a two-dimensional flat next to them for scenery. He said it was inconsistent to have those two things. So in other words, Appia was arguing for three-dimensionality. Here's one of his drawings. This is a sketch of one of his sets, Adolf Appia. And he did a lot of work for dance companies. So he had a lot of interest in kind of mysterious spaces that could serve as palaces. But he was very much a motivator also for lighting, to create a sense of mysterious lighting for a setting like this. So basically we have two types of scenery, if we want to really kind of put them in categories. You have scenery that moves, movable scenery, and then you have permanent scenery as well. So obviously, the painted scenery, if you've noticed on the front of our Blackboard site, maybe I could just bring this up just to remind you of the image that we have used as the central image in our show. It's right here in the front of our Blackboard site. If we can show that, that's great. You can see these are drops that are painted that are flown up into the fly space. So painted two-dimensional scenery worked perfectly for 19th century plays, and they were movable. So you could fly one in and out, bring in the next one. So that was easy thanks to the flying sets and the turntable sets. We had that as well for movable scenery. In fact, in this kind of arrangement, you can actually fly in what's called a box set. A box set is where you have one wall, stage left, one wall, stage right, and then an up-center wall connecting them. But you could put them on hinges so that you could fold the two walls in and fly them up into the fly space. So it was amazing some of the things that you could do with movable scenery. Also, another way of moving scenery is with wagons. You literally can put a scene, like let's say in Last Night of Ballyhoo, for instance, is a play that takes place in an interior of a home. It's a beautiful home. And it's the only set on the stage until you have to do a train scene. So what would happen is the lights go out on the big set, and you'd bring in what is technically called a wagon, not a covered wagon or anything like that, but it's literally just a scene piece that is on wheels so that you can easily move it into a place, let's say down left, and light that one little section just to have that scene or that scene where you have the meeting in the railroad car. So wagons have been used quite a lot. In fact, when Evan gets here, I'm going to ask him if he's used a lot of wagons in terms of movable scenery. And I'm sure he's used some turntables as well. We'll ask him about that. But a big show like La Cage aux Folles, which has so many different sets coming in and out, will actually use a lot of wagons coming in and out as well. So that's movable scenery. Permanent sets are also a great feature, especially if you don't have a large budget. A show like La Cage aux Folles has to have like 9 different setups, so that gets very expensive. But a multiple set is where you have one basic set on stage and you have multiple areas where you would play each scene. So for instance, Joe Mielziner's famous Death of a Salesman image, I think we have the two images here. Mielziner wanted to have the past always present, so he actually had a scrim, which is what you actually see in both of these images, a scrim that was painted to kind of give us a sense of it being far away in Willie's memory. But you actually are able, I don't know how well you can pick it out through the scrim, but There's an upstairs room there where the boys have their beds and they have a scene there. There's a downstairs room that is the kitchen where Willie and Linda talk a lot. There's a section down left where it actually leads to the garage. So in other words, what I'm saying is you have one set that never really changes, and lighting will help bring up the scene with the boys. Or then you have a change of lighting and now we're in the kitchen and we play that scene, or we go to the garage and we play that scene. So the set's always there, never moves. Lighting moves in order to give us, you know, what scene we watch. Of course, the only drawback with that is, and permanent sets, multiple sets like Meisner's were beautiful to watch. I mean, it really was an artwork. But it means that the scene that the boys play is going to be done in one little section, and the scene that Willie and Linda play is going to be done in one little section. In other words, you can't use the whole space ever. You're kind of limited to a small space no matter what scene you play. And that, for a realistic play, is a bit of a problem. It doesn't allow you to be too theatrical. Keeps you small. So that is one of the drawbacks there in multiple sets. And then there's also unit sets, which are kind of amorphous, but you can use it for a variety of different ways, and that's where it can be very conceptual. And speaking of concept, the design concept is something that really should come from the collaboration between the scene designer and the director. So it's really on the scene designer to kind of lay the foundation of just exactly where we're going to be placing this show. And by design concept, for instance, I mentioned just that Meisner, for instance, the way he used the scrim, he had a concept that he wanted to create that the play happens in the past, that it's always a kind of memory play. So the scrim became central for establishing that. But in fact, I'll talk to Evan about design concepts that he's had for instance, for In the Next Room, which was quite of a unique undertaking. But obviously, a designer has to have certain objectives, and Wilson talks about it in our textbook about how you have to obviously provide the environment for the show. You're creating a sense of mood so that you're not going to be playing a comic scene in something that seems like a funeral situation. So you have to match what the tenor of the whole scene is. Period style may come into play. In the Next Room is a good example. This is a play that happens in the 1880s. So you have to have everything, costumes, props, scenery has to fit into that time slot. That is a real challenge. So, the scenic designer also is, one of the main objectives is to make sure all the other designers work in with the concept. And that means a lot of meetings. That is kind of the answer to that question that we asked last week, that the director has to help designers to collaborate so that they're all very much in sync, especially if you're putting on a costume on stage that the lighting might really mess up in terms of its color. So there's got to be that kind of collaboration just to avoid big mistakes. But the main idea is to unify the artistic design of the show. One of the ways that that can happen, now I'll ask Evan about this too, is whether he uses a central image or a metaphor to try to focus the design work in a show. Often the script suggests this. If you read a play like Hamlet, for instance, you'll find that there's all these plots that seem to be kind of taking Hamlet and getting him out of the way. So there's a bit of a conspiracy kind of thing working in Hamlet. So a designer might want to, for instance, have everything show a kind of webbing, some kind of netting, like he's about to be caught, like some fish in a net. It may be there in the scenery. You might actually see netting there. It may be even in the costumes, just the way the certain sections of the costume might have some like netted fabric. So it could be a design item that works through a number of things. The lighting designer might want to show a gobo that reflects on the floor and has a kind of jail-like netting quality there. So this is where you take a central image and you kind of run it through the whole show to create that sense of unity throughout all the areas of design. One of the famous directors that established this was Bertolt Brecht. When he did shows like Mother Carriage, for instance, he would have a single wagon that Mother Carriage pulls around the whole space, and everything that she comes in contact to is kind of built in the same kind of structure as the wagon. So there is a kind of consistency in everything, even in the costumes. So, the metaphor, if you will, of this wagon works to be kind of the central image for the show. Also, and hopefully we'll be able to get to see a ground plan, example of a ground plan. This is really what a director uses with the scene designer to create a sense. Oh, here's a good example of what a ground plan does. It's basically as if you're standing on top of the theater looking down at the stage floor to see the arrangement of the furniture. You're seeing all the objects that occupy the floor of the setting. And it's a great tool for communicating the situation of the scene. It's a map for the director to work out their blocking, who walks where, stands when, at certain points. So ground plans are really a fabulous tool. It's one of the first things, perhaps, that is created there between the designer and the director. And there are certain rules, to some extent, that you have to admire that and adhere to in ground plans. For instance, you may wonder, why do we put a sofa away from the wall in a set on stage? Even though you at home in your apartment usually put a sofa up against the wall. Well, it's kind of a convention that you want to bring the action out to the audience. You don't want to keep it back at the walls. So we tend to want to create an obstacle course of the furniture and bring it out. We also don't want to block entrances with furniture. So, I mean, that's a given. Good designers try to get at least 5 acting areas in a ground plan so that the director has a chance to use the entire space. If you just do a play that has one couch there, everything is going to be there at that one couch, and you're not going to have anything motivated to go anywhere else. So some of these rules, if you will, are just to create interest, the same way that instead of having just a flat wall, you usually have jags in the wall so that it creates tension and creates interest, visual interest for the audience. There's the idea of putting windows on the sides so that actors can go to them and look out and you can get their reaction. Whereas the best entrances into a space are from upstage so that as soon as you walk through the door, the whole audience sees you. Whereas if you want to exit an actor, it's best to have a downstage door so that they can exit more easily. In the same way that you tend to want to make sure that the hinges on a door are upstage so that when the door is opened upstage, the door isn't itself blocking the actor. So there is also a lot of small rules that good scene designers have to remember about observing sight lines, for instance, making sure that you are able to see if a person has a seat that's way up in the back, will the border, the top border, block their view of actors actually on the stage? So a good scene designer knows that you have to have your sight lines working very well. So there's a lot of rules for design, and we're going to probably talk about that when we bring Evan Bartoletti in, our guest for the second half. So we'll take a little break here as we bring our guest in, and Evan's going to show us a lot of visuals from his work. In fact, those of you who saw In the Next Room will be able to see the original designs that Evan created for that production. So I hope you join us to meet Evan Bartoletti, our special guest on scene design, in the second half. So we'll see you then.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
of our brothers feel like they're a part of a family, whether it's the culture, color of the skin, or just being comfortable with other men. The bond keeps growing, and the brotherhood keeps strengthening itself through those means. The Male Success Alliance at Cal State Dominguez Hills is creating a genuine brotherhood.
It does not force you to be anything. It does not require you to be a certain type of student.
We're here emotionally, physically, and anytime a brother needs anything, we're going to be there.
A lot of times, men of color aren't seen as professional, or you don't even see them in professional settings. So the Male Success Alliance is trying to get our men ready within their undergrad to be in that professional setting because they are the professional. The manner that the program is doing this is through the concentration of being there for our brothers. The practical way of doing that is, you know, redefining and strengthening the brotherhood, you know, within the campus and through the workshops and different events that we have. The suit is that signal that we're trying to create. You know, that whole changing the narrative is coming through the suit. When a man is able to be clean, they feel good. It gives us confidence and it oozes out of the guys.
Watching Dr. Franklin and Matt Smith, you know, walk around in these nice suits, it's like, hey, I want to be like that. I want to be him one day. I want to be able to wear that nice suit.
And you see it the results are better academics, more social, a better social life. And a lot of guys just want to be a part of the program because of it.
The Male Success Alliance found me in a very interesting time place, trying to balance classes and my home life. I started to really fail in many ways. I found MSA on my verge of not being a student anymore. Meeting the actual student body president of the Male Success Alliance, I met him and it was like, nah, brother, you are my brother, and anything you need from me, just let me know.
And that's what MSA is built on. How does each one teach one, and how do we bring our brothers along with us? And that's why MSA sets that legacy in terms of, it's not just about CSU Dominguez Hills, it's this region, it's this state, and it's the nation, and these young men are going to change all of them.
My name is Alex Guerrero, and I'm a Toro.
My name is James Harris, and I'm a Toro.
I'm Jordan Sylvester, and I'm a Toro.
My name is Zanaya Fitz, and I'm a senior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills, majoring in psychology. The reason I came to this campus was for its diversity and learning environment. Thank you.
Hi, my name is Mar Briones, and I'm a junior here at California State University, Dominguez Hills. I'm a business major, and the reason why I chose this campus was because of its location and good business program.
Maybe you know how to use some of these platforms, but do you know how to make them work for your business interests? Most programs tell you to start with great content, but do they tell you how to create that great content? Creating effective content that can build a viral momentum is the hardest part of social media marketing. That's where we come in. The Certificate Program in Social Media Strategies and Content Marketing is a content-based course of study. During this 48-hour intensive immersion program, you will learn how to understand why some content goes viral while other content fails to gain traction. Identify your target audience, connect with them, and build them into a community. Create content that is specifically designed to inspire a positive emotional response and encourage engagement with your target audience. Distribute your content across the social platforms that are most appropriate for your specific goals. Become a thought leader in your area of expertise. This program is designed to help business owners, artists, and other creatives promote their professional ventures. If you're employed in public relations, advertising, marketing, journalism, publishing, education, or government affairs, this certificate can give you a professional edge toward promotions. If you're seeking employment in these areas, this certificate will let corporate recruiters know that you understand the importance of social media literacy. Enroll now.
For a $250,000equity investment in my company, in return you'll get 10%.
How are we going to fund this? We are going to be a nonprofit organization. We are looking to the Gates Foundation to help us cover our costs.
Hi, my name is Obi Wogboy, and I'm currently a junior at California State University, Dominguez Hills. The reason I came to this school is for the great environment, the small class sizes, and the amazing sociology program.
You are watching DHTV from California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, everyone. Welcome back. I'm very delighted to introduce you to a very special friend and a really talented scenic artist in Evan Bartoletti. Evan is an award-winning designer. He's found creative expression doing scene design for the stage, screen, opera, dance, or wherever artistry is in demand. His projects have ranged from the delightful Enter Laughing, which he did at the Wallace Annenberg Center in Beverly Hills, to the sensational Dream Girls. I think we have some images to show you of that at the North Shore Musical Theater in Boston, and the spectacular Rent at the Hollywood Bowl, and the beautiful Treasures of the Walt Disney Archives exhibit at the Ronald Reagan Presidential Library and Museum. So he's done a lot of varied work. Evan's been a designer and a guest lecturer at the theater department here since 2013 when he started with a production of Cabaret. And he really appreciates the wonderful opportunity to teach, collaborate, and share his knowledge that he's received as an apprentice. So I'm sure you'll join me in welcoming Evan Bartoletti.
Hello.
Evan, thank you so much for coming. This
sure,
is
my
great.
Pleasure.
I've done a number of shows with Evan, and Evan has done so many of our shows over the last number of years that it's always fun to see what he's cooking up next. So
they're always different. There's a range of material. Yeah,
mm-hmm.
It's great.
Yes, and that's unique about our shows is that we really do have not any special narrow kind of area that we choose from. We have quite a variety. So I'm eager to ask you. I don't think I've ever talked to you about this. Where did you first get started in this? Because how does a scene designer even get the idea?
Design scenes, yeah.
Designing for the theater?
Well, if I want to go way back, you know, I was the kid that was doing sort of elaborate setups for Halloween.
Okay.
The front yard would become the graveyard, and it wasn't just...
That's where it starts.
Right, a few props and set pieces. It was smoke and lights and music and the whole, all of the scenic elements. So, and then as it sort of evolved, I was working with friends, mostly filmmakers, young people that just wanted to mostly make movies, you know, as opposed to do theater per se. But
so you didn't get a job at Knott's Berry Farm?
No. Nor Disneyland, yeah. But I just started helping out, and I was always the person that was helping with the setting and the looks of things. Mm-hmm. And then I started doing small theater, and then I got a job for a small studio for working for ARCO Atlantic Richfield. Mm-hmm. And we would do trade shows and conferences and different things like that. And so it was just a small group of us. There were two senior sort of designers and a nice sort of apprentice with them. Mm-hmm. And we would come up with a theme for a conference or something. And we would design and build something. And we'd take it and set it up on location and kind of run things behind the scenes.
Sounds like you've been practical for a long time then.
Yeah, I mean, I think it was really great because it was small enough that you had your specialty, but there was no there were no divas. You had to jump in and do whatever was necessary. So if it was electrical or if it was carpentry, you just did it. Everybody would work together and finish things off. Yeah.
So I have to ask you this question. It's not an easy question, but what is it that appeals to you so much to do scene design? Is there something in it for you that is that makes a kind of personal passion? Is there a...
That's actually an easy question because it's something that I answered for myself a long time ago in the sense that I was growing up and I was always artistic. You know, I could sort of paint and draw, but I didn't know what I wanted to do with that. And so I went to school and studied fine art. I studied graphic art and design. I studied architecture. Mm-hmm. But as I found that I was doing these work and helping out friends, that I was applying all of these different things in one area, and that was scenic design, which is to say that it's color theory, it's composition, it's sculptural, you know, it's paint, and it's collaborative. You know, so you start off with that story, and the director comes in and says, I'm thinking about this idea or this approach. The other designers, the line designer, the costumer, they have specific
ideas. I mean, it's
wonderfully
collaborative. And you've been
that way with
us for so many years. It's been great. But it is so technical. I'd be curious to also ask you, especially for our students who are curious, what goes into a career of becoming a scene designer? Like you mentioned architecture. I would think that would be ideal for someone who's thinking of scene design to have some architecture background.
Yeah, because you need to have a sense, I mean, drafting in terms of being able to, you know, draw out your ideas. I mean, it varies by industry. I mean, in theory, you can design and you can hire someone who can do the drafting for you.
Mm-hmm.
You know, like in film, the set designer is really the draftsperson, whereas sort of the production designer, art director is the one who's doing more of the conceptual and set dressing and the like. But yeah, it all goes to the same place. I mean, mm-hmm. it just, you know, like anything, whether you're an actor or the director, you know, the more things you know about what goes into the mix, just I think the better
you
are.
So you must have studied a lot. Well, I should study. Yeah. You must have taken a lot of drawing classes. You must have taken a lot of drafting classes,
yeah.
Right?
I mean, I was, you know, I had that talent to begin with, and mm-hmm. so I was able to sort of channel it. But I took, yeah, I took architecture classes first, so I learned how to draft, essentially. Mm-hmm. But I got bored with it because it was always straight lines, you know. But then in art classes, drafting and learning how to just draw people or things, I took perspective, you know, mm-hmm. so that helped me. Mm-hmm. This was, you know, I'm dating myself, pre-computer 3D imagery mm-hmm. and that those drafting tools. I mean, it existed. I'm not that old, but you were still drawing in perspective. So there were very specific rules about how to create the look that you wanted.
Right.
Always shortcuts. You can take a photograph and sort of mm-hmm. you know mm-hmm. copy it, get mm-hmm. a sense of the room. With the lines and stuff like that, just to do a quick sketch. Mm-hmm. But then at a certain point, you get past that and you can just kind of do it from your mind's eye. You don't have to rely on those sorts of things.
Well, I want everybody to know like the background that you're coming from, because we're going to look at a lot of Evan's drawings and ground plans, renderings, and photographs of his actual shows. And so it's going to make you wonder, wow, you must have had a lot of training to be able to pull off that kind of work. So my first question is, I was just talking in the earlier broadcast about design concepts.
Yes.
Is that something that you like working with, of coming up with a kind of concept for how you're going to put on a show?
Yes. Yeah, very much so. I'm of the philosophy or the mind that if you come up with a concept, that when things change, because inevitably they will, in terms of more or less time, more or less money, mm-hmm. Whatever, this is the type of the venue, the materials that are available, that are not available, I think it, you know, gives you something to work towards.
Right.
And so you can, you know, hopefully just sort of adapt it and improvise as you go along, but keep working towards that sort of end goal.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, you know, we tend to think of a concept as something so, like, imaginative, but sometimes it's just practical. Because after all, if you can identify how we're doing this, then everybody can fit into it.
Yeah, exactly.
Not just the designers, but the actors and the director as well. So in a way, it helps give us a channel to follow.
Well, yeah, because hopefully it inspires, you know, other people. I'm always amazed because the director or someone else will come in and say, oh, well, I was thinking that we could do this. I was like, I hadn't thought of that. Mm-hmm. You know, mm-hmm. I mean, I thought of a lot of things, but not specifically that. That's great. You know, so hopefully, mm-hmm. yeah, it elevates things. And again, it goes towards that collaborative mm-hmm. endeavor so that it just...
Well, I have a perfect example of your design concept to start with.
Okay.
Those of you who got to see In the Next Room here at Dominguez Hills, I know a lot of the students wrote already about it and were fascinated with the show. But this is where it starts. This is Evan's design concept. You can see his scenic design concept. And I'm going to ask you to kind of talk us through this. I mean, I don't think that they could actually read this out here, but here's an overview of the actual play. And here's an image, for instance, that Evan chose. And like, here's another Japanese image. Can you describe what fascinated you about this? And I'm going to take you through this entire document that he has created. Look how long this is. It goes on for like 15, 20 pages, but let's just start. What was it that made you select this, for instance?
So going back to what you were saying earlier, so the very top, it says, so this is just presenting ideas so that, you know, everyone kind of knows that we're on the same page, or mm-hmm. this is sort of the goal, the concept, right? Mm-hmm. So it's just a presentation ideas, and then overview is just basically saying, you know, this is sort of the essence of the story. The black and white image that's on the right-hand side is an Aubrey Beardsley illustration. Because the concept for us was to create this very specific Victorian interior in a more graphic design approach, which is to say really just smooth, flat walls, With paint treatment instead of doing something that would be more expensive and more elaborate for the period.
So you're really playing around with a kind of graphic design idea of this Victorian woman lounging here on this couch, but it's very much a kind of graphic design, not a heavy interior as you would see in Victorian society.
Right. Yeah, not. I mean, there's no sort of wallpaper there that's indicated or anything else like that. There's a little bit of a sofa or something behind them.
So now you have a Japanese...
Yeah, the wood block, I mean, it's getting ahead of things a little bit. Well, maybe not, because the bullet points kind of talk specifically more about the concept. But, you know, I sketched out the room layout, because In the Next Room is very specific in the sense that it requires that you have these two rooms side by side. So an operating theater on one side and a living room on the other.
Right.
And in center, there's a short wall that has a door in it.
Mm-hmm. Now, this isn't the set here, right? What is this?
No, I wish. Now, this was, in doing research, I came across, this was a production of, I think, The Importance of Being Earnest. It was done in Australia, and I don't know who the designer is, but in this, I believe they did it as a storybook, which is to say why it's really sort of only two walls. Mm-hmm. But this, to me, was that concept beautifully executed, right? So it's that graphic design. It goes towards that sort of Aubrey Beardsley style.
I think you can see that Evan was looking for something that had a little bit of a kind of graphic feeling, and he came across a picture of a different show. This isn't the show
nothing,
we're doing.
Yeah, there's nothing
this
new
is
under the sun.
Importance of Being Earnest. So yeah. I mean, you're looking for inspiration where you can find it, and sometimes other scene designs can give you an idea. You're not going to actually do this set, but you can be inspired by the elements of it.
Right. And so when talking to the director, you know, we talked specifically about the room layout and, you know, furniture pieces and like that. But for her, she did not want to do the black and white. You know, we talked about that in terms of, conceptually it could work in the sense that it kind of reinforces maybe some of the different themes of the play, which is to say sort of man and woman, sort of rational and emotional, something, you know, these sort of yin and yang opposites. But she didn't want to do that. It was too stark. So in doing some more research, I found Japanese wood blocks.
So these...
And so you have this, off-white background. I mean, it's sort of yellowed with age, but essentially an indigo, a really dark blue. And so those color swatches were to say, we could do a warm palette, like off-white and dark brown, or we could do a cool sort of palette with a pale blue and a dark blue. And what we decided was to split it so we had a warm off-white background and then the dark blue sort of detailing. Mm-hmm. And then there's
Let me
examples.
Give them an image of what the actual show turned out to look like so that this kind of can make sense to you. So here's a great image of the show. I'll open it a little bigger here.
Yeah.
But you can see a lot of that same thing, that graphic sense that Evan was just talking about, is there in the actual set. And a little bit more of that Japanese woodcut is here rather than that initial graphic black and white.
Right, and we did, you know, all of our furniture pieces were much more practical, like, you know, than in the reference photo from The Importance of Being Earnest, you know.
Right, so you had exact Victorian furniture here.
Right.
This is in the stage left room. I don't know if you can tell, but this is actually a wall right here, and there's a door in there that leads to the next room, and this is where all the...
The examination, operating,
strange things happen in the next room, right? let me go back to this. But, I mean, look at the degree that Evan has gone to in researching so many different aspects of fixtures that might be applicable to the show.
Yeah, and there
the
are some, you know, wall treatments. Terms of pavement, sort of, you know, more Art Nouveau, but then there's a small sketch there.
So you can see that a designer is drawing, it's like you're kind of gathering information in as well that you might want to use.
Right, and then processing it in terms of just, you know, as a way to communicate either with the other designers, the other people that you're working with, or whomever, in terms of just getting the idea out there.
And then here's some of your sketches that actually show this is how the vibrator machine was
set up.
Right, because
that's a specific prop, it's a
examination
table. So this was, you know, some different ideas about how to approach that, specific light fixtures, because the play sets, it takes place where electricity is brand new, it's a new technology. And so there are a lot of light fixtures.
This is wonderful. And that,
and then sort of lighting examples for the lighting designer to get a sense of things. So do you want to show them the backdrop? Yeah, that one. So that was our painted backdrop.
Yeah, this comes in at the end of the play and covers what you just saw, the interior, while they perform this scene in the snow.
In the garden, yeah, they're supposed to...
Resolution to the...
Inside the house, and then all of a sudden they're just supposed to magically go out into the winter garden. And so that was our solution.
That is quite wonderful. Yeah. Let me go back here, too. I want to show you something that Evan has just been working on. And this is a video of a show that... is done with a dance company. So it's not theater at all, but it's, I think you'll see how very unusual this is in that you've got dancers here who are working with items that are kind of floating around them. So it's almost like the design items are dancing along with the dancers. You have to see a little bit of it to understand what I'm saying.
So click here, the wide screen in the bottom corner there.
Yeah, there you go.
So it goes full. Yeah.
Great. So, I think we could talk over this, Evan. What's the name of the company that you're...
So, Voices Carry Inc. is the company. And Madeline Levitt is the artistic director. I've worked with her on and off for maybe 15 years now. We did sort of a play musical first, and then we've done dance since then. This idea started years ago in the sense that she wanted to do a dance piece, contemporary dance, but she wanted to incorporate puppets. She met a puppeteer in New York who created these abstract puppets.
But you can see the movements are very puppet-like.
Yeah.
Right?
Yeah, they're stringed puppets. So in that sense, they're, I guess, somewhat conventional.
Ooh, but it's a great movement.
Yeah. So... we did a workshop in New York, came back to Los Angeles. I set up a little puppet grid in the artistic director's dance studio. And we just started working with some different elements that we had workshopped, which is to say just fabric moving, the sticks. There was another one that was different balls of yarn that was a little bit more figurative and specific in terms of...
This is uncanny, the way you have the material actually kind of dancing out there with the actors.
That was, yeah.
With the dancers. That is... The whole set is alive.
Right. Oh, there's the... So there's our dog. That's probably the most realistic of sort of the puppets. But so the challenge for me was we're doing puppets and we need puppeteers in addition to the dancers. And traditionally in a dance piece, it's really mostly an open stage. So how do you, you know, where do you incorporate that? And for me, what I wanted to do was I wanted them upstage, the puppeteers to be upstage, so that it added another layer to the dance. So that you saw the puppeteer sort of moving in silhouette, in addition to the dancers interacting with these abstract puppets.
Oh my gosh, this is so wonderful. What a great concept, but also the execution of it is...
It came together beautifully. Fabulous. It was like 3 years in the making. we had an original musical score. It was just something, you know, of our own creation. And I think everyone was very proud of what we put together.
Listen, I would love for you to talk a little bit more too about some of the shows that you've done for us.
Sure.
But I want to show them Dreamgirls. I promised them Dreamgirls.
Oh, yeah, that's right.
Can you explain a little bit about the set that you did for Dreamgirls here?
So North Shore Music Theater is done in the round, as you can see there. So
and this is very unusual because we talked about, the students wrote about how they really prefer proscenium, but it's
pros
amazing
and cons
what
to
you
it.
Can
yeah.
accomplish in arenas. And
right. There's something it's very dynamic about it, and in many ways, I don't know if cinematic's the right word, but you just... You think more in terms of background, middle ground, and foreground, you know, because everybody's looking through the stage, you know. So, for example, I don't know if you can zoom in a little bit, up the aisle that's sort of in the center there is where we created the Apollo Theater. So there was there was a landing. We did a lighted sign with just with a sparkly drape and the microphone. So that way we could have these scenes play out in the house. And then we bring people down the aisle onto the stage. And this was another thing that we did in terms of we just created a platform and a railing.
Mm-hmm.
I think this was for scenes where they were in Las Vegas, right?
Mm-hmm.
And then the array that you see above, they normally have a grid that just hangs over the stage.
Uh-huh.
What I did
was added?
Right, I created this sort of three-sided proscenium. And mm-hmm. what you don't see in this were there were three sort of hollow legs that came down. Oh. And so two legs would come in to create a proscenium opening because they're always sort of going on and off stage,
oh,
right?
Cool.
Sometimes they're in the wing,
right.
sometimes
sure.
they're in the, yeah. But you can get an idea with this. So the Apollo Theater's, you know, in the house there,
mm-hmm.
and then we could have different set pieces pop up from underneath the stage.
Right.
So that just intimated a door frame in terms of them being backstage.
How wonderful.
Yeah.
What a terrific
show. So there's the
show.
Apollo, yeah. So there's more to it. They had an elevator in the center, so we could bring up the makeup tables for when they're in the dressing rooms. They had an elevator that came up from the side, so you could bring up scenery from one of the other quadrants. And then you can also fly scenery in different places, but it just it just requires a different approach.
That is quite wonderful.
Because you're working
wonderful.
360. Yeah.
Really. I do want to share with them a little bit more of the work that you've done here at Dominguez as
yeah.
well, but it's amazing how your career is involving not just, you know, Dominguez Hills and other theaters, but you're doing film work as well.
A little bit, yeah. It's been a while since I've done any specific film or television mm-hmm. stuff, mostly live theater, live events and the like. But yeah,
let's start with your first show here. This was Cabaret, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Great. Tell us a little bit about, is there a concept that goes along with...
this was my first time working here, so it was fairly straightforward in the sense that, Cabaret requires an orchestra, so we're going to put them in the orchestra pit, we're going to create a proscenium, sort of our own false proscenium for the show, so that's what we did there. And then what I wanted to do was... was create a mural in behind. And mm-hmm. so the mural I was trying to come up with something that had a feeling yes. of maybe a parade, you know, but also maybe people being marched off,
right.
you know, and just kind of playing a little bit with that sort of duality of not, because this is, it's a run up to the Nazis really taking over. It quite hasn't happened yet. So things...
Right.
you know, start to change very quickly and become very grim in anticipation of...
That was excellent. I thought what you did with your materials, with the cloth, gave that show a kind of warmth that it usually doesn't have because you want to, you know, hit very hard with the kind of social message of the show. But it kind of warmed it up a little bit, even though our, you know, Kit Kat girls were pretty rough still.
Yeah.
Can you talk about The Promise, which is a show that you did last year here, last spring?
Yeah, Shoni also directed that. So The Promise is much more sort of magic realism. I mean, it's it all takes place in the backyard of a house, but there's just a lot of magic, and there are a lot of very specific sort of props and different things that happen. So the corn bleeds, and I don't know if you can see sort of down left here. Yeah, there was a
kind of an altar.
Statue of the Madonna, yeah,
yeah.
with an altar, and then the house. And
and then there's a chicken coop here,
right.
and a chicken comes out and dances.
And dances,
right?
Yeah.
Obviously, it's an actress.
And then a coffin
actor.
Gets delivered, you know, and then there's a body in the coffin, a skeleton in the coffin, all these sort
because
of crazy
Because when you first
things.
Look at this, you don't think, well, is it really a realistic place? It has a little something extra that makes it
So that's what we try to do,
strange.
Is just make it sort of kind of weird and wonderful,
mm-hmm.
you know. And so I went through, we don't have the concept paper for this, but that was one of my initial sketches, trying to place everything again. And trying to, get a sense of things. Like with the altar... something I had seen that I wanted to emulate was using a dresser or a piece of furniture with the drawers out and having the drawers filled with stuff
uh-huh.
that would be part of like an ofrenda or something.
That's wonderful.
And then have the statue on
That's
top
great.
Of that with your candles and different things.
Mm-hmm.
In the corn, there was another sculpture installation that I saw that I wanted to, again, emulate so that mm-hmm. we weren't trying to create like realistic looking corn. Because the corn starts off very low at the beginning of mm-hmm. the play, and by the end of the play, it's mature, mm-hmm. and then at the very end, it's supposed to bleed. So So I think those sorts of things, it lends itself. So you just, I try to look at different reference material, whether it's, yeah, art or design, architecture, film, other theater, just, you know, whatever it is.
This so was she kills monsters. Tell us about this one.
This was, again, a bit of a challenge because you have someone who's living in the world of Dungeons and Dragons. I mean, she's a school teacher by day, but then she inherits the diary of her dead sister, and as she, you know, reads through, it's not really the diary, I guess it is a diary, but she learns about her sister and the gaming and this fantasy world that she occupied. And so it jumps in and out. So I just wanted something that was more a bit more fantastical.
Yeah, it's a little like Stranger Things. I mean, they jump into this this amazing world where
monsters
all of a sudden they have their own kind of avatar, if you will, and they fight scenes.
Right.
And in fact, the show is very complicated because you have to have someone really good at stage combat to do all of these scenes. It's a humorous show. I mean, it's funny, but you got to have some serious stage combat as well.
Definitely. So we created a few little levels for that, but then mostly just did some lightweight painted fabric that we can open and close just to help kind of create spaces, maybe in a little bit more of a Brechtian fashion, so that if we had just strips of fabric, it was the forest, you know, without getting into trees and tree trunks and things. But if it opened up, then it could be the office at school or something, or you know, somebody's living room.
Is there another image for She Kills Monsters?
No, I think that was the only one.
Oh, okay.
So,
but here's Coyote.
Coyote, yeah.
And this is an interesting concept. This is one that Evan and I both worked together.
Yeah.
But why couldn't you get a normal horse?
Right.
This is Don Quixote on his famous steed, and
Rocinante.
Yeah. You know, instead of having a donkey for poor Sancho, he's actually kind of on a tricycle.
So somewhat, yeah. We thought that would be more sort of comedic. So yeah, the approach was to do something a little bit more puppet-like, right? I mean, a little more prop puppetry. So with Dapple, it was a little more straightforward in terms of make it a cart, make the donkey, you know, head, and then that way Pancho could just sort of, you know, push it around. He would be moving it around. But for Quixote, we thought it should be a little bit more, presentational. So we got a little kind of horse buggy, and we converted it. And then we had actors playing the front of the horse and the back of the horse. So it became sort of a combination of the costumes, mask work, and then that specific prop, where they could pull him around and have him ride.
So where does this kind of technical idea come from? I mean, this is kind of a unique thing to track, because how do you end up with something like this? It had to begin with
an idea,
right?
Well, you're the director, you should know. I mean, part of it is, it's the needs of the play, right? So,
well, that's where we began.
Right,
this is the famous story of Don Quixote, a man who makes up stories himself.
Right,
so it happens in the imagination. So we wanted to do something that was highly imaginative, and puppetry was kind of the focus. So this is kind of a puppet-infused play, if you will. In fact, we don't even have realistic scenery in the background. What you've created here are basically platforms that double as locations. Sometimes scenes happen underneath them. Sometimes scenes happen on top of them.
Right, and we would do shadow play.
And in the back,
the fabric,
you'd find
in the back, or
there'd be great shadows that were
Or the fabric would move in terms of creating a mountain, or, you know, whatever.
So it was like everything was done with a kind of puppetry focus. There was people operating all the elements. So all the actors were involved in, for instance, the creation of the horse and the donkey, and many of the stage business was done in a similarly manipulated way.
Right, they would bring in different prop pieces, or, you know, manipulate those to sort of change it up so that they could create a setting for a specific scene, whether it was the tavern or chapel or whatever it is. But I think the goal was to make things more sort of animated, or have the puppeteer, so that you're always seeing things evolve and change as Don Quixote's going through his imaginings and his storytelling. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Do you have any other drawings here I wanted to... this is actually from The Strings Attached.
That's Strings Attached. I thought that's a great image. Some more, so that's just one puppet. Mm-hmm. There's a specific name for that puppet. We were going with emotions for the different puppets, but so that's just one. Well, I guess the other one is there too with the sticks. It was sort of a star, right? Mm-hmm. And you can see the puppeteers upstage there. So we just created these open frame panels where they could control things. And then we just laid some mesh over that so that they can see through it. And initially we had wanted to do sort of a traditional white psych, but we ended up going with a gray sort of silk fabric that we had and just make it a little bit more, you know, muted and a little bit more understated.
It's so interesting after working with you on Quixote and to do all that kind of puppetry infused
this was a model.
Idea.
Yeah.
This is so, it's the same kind of concept here. Where you actually are seeing the manipulators on stage as well, creating it, very similar to like Bunraku, which right. involves the artistry of creating it. I am assuming that's a lot of where your fascination with puppetry is in that kind of creation aspect, not just the result there.
No, I'm fascinated with that because I know people that they'll do little hand puppets or something and. They'll be manipulating the hand puppet, and they'll be standing right next to the other actor or the performer, and yet, you know, within seconds, you're focused on the puppet, mm-hmm. and you've completely, you know, ignoring the puppeteer. Mm-hmm. I mean, you see it in other. I think Warhorse did a great job of that. Is it Handspring, a theater company? There was a Midsummer Night's Dream where they, mm-hmm. Puck was a series of objects that were
right.
came
that were
together for one,
right.
yeah, to create. But so this was the set model, initial set model. So I created sort of a eight-sided grid for the strings for the puppets, and then we just had sheer material on the sides. And then those control panels, as you can see, it had a white background because originally the idea was like we would just do kind of a traditional psych and we'd do color or maybe video projection depending on how things evolved.
You know? So depending on what project you're working on, do you like decide, oh, I need to do a rendering for this, or oh, I think I'll do a model for this, or let me do a ground plan for this? I mean, is part of your process kind of determined by, you know, what exactly you need at that certain time? Or
yeah,
do you go through a process of always doing some sketches, always doing a rendering, always doing a ground plan?
I always do sketches, and that's, I guess, my art background. I just learned to just do quick thumbnail sketches as a way to... better get ideas out, you know, and just to kind of codify things a little bit more. So, because it might be just an overall look of the set, or by one specific idea or a prop. Mm-hmm. But it runs the gamut. I mean, it depends on the time and the budget. You know, sometimes mm-hmm. You want to do something that I created a model here. The director. It helps her to like physically see things. You know, so if I can create a model, mm-hmm. it's a better tool for us to converse about the staging and all that sort of things. Mm-hmm. But it could be, you know, it'd be reference photos. You want to look similarly to this paint style or this mm-hmm. architectural style or design period, sketches, you know, whatever sort of color samples or specific samples in terms of furnishings and. Fabric, model. Now with the computers, you can do a 3D model. You can do, there's the ground plan, a section plan. Mm-hmm. You know, that starts to get more technical because you say, I've got this idea. And then you start to work in the ground plan, you realize, oh, this is a smaller stage than I thought. Mm-hmm. So you have to modify it. So maybe my walls aren't going to be as tall. Maybe they're not going to be as wide or whatever that may be. You know, so different designers have, I think, different approaches in terms of what comes first. You know, usually for me it's starting with the story. So this was, yeah, Nice Fish.
Yeah, so this is a nice sketch that you did here for Nice Fish.
Right. So Nice Fish, the setting, it's a frozen lake. It's just supposed to be this frozen lake. There's a lot of quick scenes. It's not quite magic realism. It's a little surreal too. It just gets very weird and wonderful.
Mm-hmm.
Practical in the sense that they're fishing in the holes and people and things are popping up from underneath the ice, right?
Right.
So I had to create a raised platform. But if you go back, so that's a back view.
Mm-hmm.
So that's the front view. So what we did was that front section is practical for the actors, and then those two sections that you saw in the previous picture, so that middle section and that back section were just scenic, right? So they just were painted to look like the lake was going out into the distance, but it couldn't support any weight. And so it was cheaper and easier to do that and to sort of fill the space and make it look bigger than it was.
So just like during the Renaissance, when the actors had to stay downstage and the scenery was upstage.
Exactly, right. There's all these tricks. I mean, it's the same, you know.
Well, Evan, I knew we were going to run out of time today, but we got a little bit of a look at your work.
Thank you. Yeah.
But thank you for bringing all of this. You do such fascinating work. I really am very impressed. So thank you for sharing it with us today.
I appreciate that.
I'm sure my students will enjoy it.
Yeah.
Thank you so much.
You're welcome.
Next week, we're going off to costumes. So we'll see you then for Theater 100.